Good morning.
Good morning.
And happy 4th of July.
Happy 4th of July.
Oh, very good. Some of you did that. And welcome back to 8:30 Church. Can we have a round of thanksgiving to God? Wonderful to have things back at the normal time. Gradually, God is returning us to normalcy, and thanks and praise be to Him. A couple of announcements before we begin. First of all, for those you don't know, I'm Pastor Tom Van Duzer, a retired pastor, helping out. Been preaching a lot during Pastor Phil's study break over at the Shawnee campus, and Pastor Mark's on vacation this weekend, so here I am. Make sure and check out the two displays in the gathering area, and pick up also this explanation of the remembrances and reflections. It's on the podium there. It'll give you a little explanation. Thanks to Tom Perry for doing a great job on that. Where's Tom? He's right back there, our seniors director. Great job, Tom. Also, VBS is coming July 12th and 15th. We had a great one over at Shawnee, and we expect to have a good one here at Mission as well. If you have children in your neighborhood, now's the time to consider having them enroll in our Vacation Bible School. Let's make sure and take just a second to clear our hearts, prepare ourselves so that God's Word can speak to us this morning. And let's rise now for our call to worship and invocation. O Lord, to you I lift up my eyes, who are enthroned in the heavens. Our eyes look to the Lord our God. Have mercy upon us, O Lord. Have mercy upon us. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear friends, as disciples of Jesus, we are called to go out into the world to proclaim the kingdom of God, just as Jesus' first disciples were called to do so. Yet often we shy away from this calling. We readily stay in our comfort zone. Instead of sharing the good news of Jesus, we claim to be too busy or suggest others can share Jesus' love more effectively than we can. Father, forgive us. Dear friends, God's power is made perfect in our weakness. The grace of God covers your sins. You are forgiven for Jesus' sake. Thanks be to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, send us as witnesses to your kingdom and fill our hearts with joy in your promises of salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated, dear friends. Of course, we are still not passing the offering plates. That'll be the next thing maybe we'll get back to here. But make sure and give your offering on the way out in the offering tray, or check the online options. For our folks who are with us online, we appreciate that, and encourage you also to check out the online options on the church website. Today, we have lessons concerning God calling people like you and me to do His work. Our first lesson is from Ezekiel chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. And God said to me, Son of man, stand on your feet, and I will speak to you. And as He spoke to me, the Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard Him speaking to me. And He said to me, Son of man, I send you to the people of Israel, to nations of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants also are impudent and stubborn. I send you to them, and you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God. And whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they will know that a prophet has been among them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second lesson is from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, 1 through 10. It's also our message text for today. This is what Paul says concerning his life and his ministry. He said, I must go on boasting, though there's nothing to be gained by it. I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up into the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know. But God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth, but I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So, to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. And let's read this last sentence together. It's our theme for today. For when I am weak, then I am strong. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Miss Beth with our children's message.
Hello, welcome to the children's message. My name is Beth, and can you see what I have with me here today? I have two water bottles, and you know, it's really fun to get the water out of this water bottle because it has a straw, and so you just buy it and take a sip, okay? And then another way you could get water out, if you didn't want to do it that way, is you could take the lid off, and then you could get water out of it this way, right? Maybe you have a water bottle at home that looks kind of similar to my two water bottles, or maybe yours look a little different. Now, what I was wondering is, do you think I can fill up my water bottles the same way I can take water out? Do you think both ways of taking the water out of the water bottle will work to put it back in? Well, let's try it out. So I have a little water here today. So first I have my water bottle with the lid on. And so I'm going to try to pour water back into it the way I got water out of it. Okay. And I don't think that's going to work. Okay, but now let's try the other one with the lid off. Do you think that'll work better? Okay. All right, which one worked better, do you think? I think the one with the lid off worked better. And you know what? That reminds me of our Bible story for today, the gospel reading. It comes from the book of Mark in the New Testament. It's a gospel where Jesus is talking to some people. And there's two towns mentioned. So when you hear the gospel reading read here in just a couple minutes, I want you guys to pay attention to the two towns. And one town was ready to receive what Jesus had to give them, to fill them up with his love. And one town wasn't ready for that, and they were kind of closed off. And so when Jesus had his love for them, that he was ready to fill them up with, they were closed off like this first water bottle, and they weren't able to hear that yet. And then the other town that Jesus went to with his disciples, they were ready, they were open and ready to hear what Jesus and his disciples had to say. And they were able to be filled up with God's love. Okay, and what we want to remember about that for our lives today is that we are able to be filled up with Christ's love. When we are baptized and we're brought into God's family, right, we receive the Holy Spirit that is with us for life. And God promises to always be there for us, to love us, forgive us, and help us share that love with other people so they can be filled up too. Okay, so as you guys go about your week this week, and when you think about maybe having a full water bottle or a full cup full of water, I want you guys to think about Christ's love that fills us up so that we can fill up others too, okay? And so to help us remember to do that, let's pray today. And let's pray like we always do. Let's fold our hands, bow our heads, and close our eyes so that nothing can distract us, okay? Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus. Help us to share your love with those people around us. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, bye guys.
Thank you so much, Beth. Let's rise for our gospel lesson. From Mark chapter 6, verses 1 through 13, Jesus begins his ministry. And Jesus went away from there and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. And on the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get these things? What's the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household. And he could do no mighty work there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went about among the villages teaching. And he called the 12 and began to send them out, two by two, and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. And he said to them, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place will not receive you and will not listen to you, then when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated, dear friends. I have a new word for you for today. The word is paraprosdokion. Let's see if we can, anybody heard of a paraprosdokion? It's a figure of speech, you know, you've got homonyms and antonyms and things like this. But a paraprosdokion, it was a favorite of Winston Churchill. It's a figure of speech in which the latter part of the sentence, the phrase or the discourse, is really unexpected, and it causes you to sit up and reinterpret the first part, and often it's very funny. Perhaps the most famous is Henny Youngman's old, "Take my wife, please." Remember that one? Yeah. "Sorry, ladies," my wife said, "don't use that." There. Homer Simpson once said, "If I could say a few words, I'd be a better public speaker." Stephen Colbert, "If I'm reading this graph correctly, I'd be very surprised." Groucho Marx was famous for them. He said, "I've had a perfectly wonderful evening, but this isn't it." Yeah. Well, famous one that I like from our own denomination, our former synodical president, Gerald Kieschnick, said, "You know, behind every successful man is a very surprised mother-in-law." And think about it. Well, Paul gives us a paraprosdokion in our text for today. And we're going to take a look at this. "But Jesus said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in...'" And you think, wow, my power must be made perfect in wonderful speaking, in formative miracles, in continued excellence, in overcoming faith. But no, "therefore I'll gladly boast all the more, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses. My grace is sufficient for you," God had said, "for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I'll boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses. What in the world is this all about? Should Christians try to be weak? Should we raise our kids to be pushovers? Does God love wimps? We're going to talk about it here. Let me give you a little situation here. Paul was the 13th apostle. Remember the 12 that Jesus called? That was in our gospel lesson today. Judas, of course, died by his own hand. And Matthias was chosen very shortly after that to fill out the 12, 12 being a very significant number in the New Testament. And many scholars believe that the disciples acted too rashly and that God had his eye on somebody special who would end up being Saul, or renamed Paul. Of course, Paul was the great missionary of God. He took the gospel to Rome, to the largest city of its day. But he had this illness. It was, nobody quite knows. Some scholars believe it was epilepsy. Still others, my thought is that it was a debilitating blindness. Eye infections were common in the Middle East. They didn't have antibiotics, and they were always in the dust and the sun. And Paul, later on in some of his letters, realizes that he couldn't write this. He had other people write for him, even though he was a very grammatical person. We don't know exactly what it was. He wasn't physically imposing. And he even says, I'm not really a very good speaker. Yet God had used him greatly. And the church was growing rapidly. And there was reason to be proud. Wow, look at what's happening. In fact, Paul struggled all his life with pride. C.S. Lewis, the great Christian writer, said this, a proud man is always looking down on people. And of course, as long as you are looking down, you cannot see the things that are up above you. God needed to deal with Paul's pride. Indeed, there were legitimate reasons for him to be proud. Let's take a little look at Paul's life. The first one is this, 2 Corinthians 12. We read this, and I don't know if you caught it. He said, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven and heard inexpressible things. Paul's speaking about himself here. Apparently, he had some, we don't quite know what it was, but some ecstatic vision that nobody else had that just confirmed his faith. And, you know, why would God choose him for this to be caught up into the third heaven? What does that mean? Wow, we don't know. But Paul had quite a pedigree. He says, you know, I love how Eugene Peterson translates this in the Message translation. He says, you know my pedigree, a legitimate birth, circumcised on the eighth day, an Israelite from the elite tribe of Benjamin, a strict and devout adherent to God's law, a fiery defender of the purity of my religion, even to the point of persecuting the church, a meticulous observer of everything set down in God's law book. There's a reason for pride. Not only that, but he was a prodigy. He tells us in Galatians 1, I was so enthusiastic about the traditions of my ancestors that I advanced head and shoulders above my peers. He was young and he was a climber. He was getting there. And he was tough. He tells us this in 2 Corinthians 11. He says, I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews 40 lashes minus one. Can you imagine that? To be flogged that many times. 3 times I was beaten with a rod. Once I was pelted with stones. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I've been in danger in the rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city and in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. Paul had reason to sort of be proud. What about you? Is there something that you are very proud of? You say, well, you know, my heritage, we've got presidents in our line. We go right back to the Mayflower. I knew somebody who one time is a descendant of Davy Crockett. Wow, that's pretty cool. Maybe you're really proud of your accomplishments. You've done some really remarkable things in your career. Maybe you're just so proud about your kids. They've turned out well, and you're just so excited that they have accomplished things. Maybe you're proud of your spiritual strength. You know, during COVID, I was here whenever the church was open. We need to be careful about pride, dear friends. A little bit about 4th of July, and I need to tell you, we need to be careful about our pride as Americans. Now, my son-in-law and grandson and I were out at the K on Friday night watching a ball game, and they had the fireworks, and they sang, I'm proud to be an American. Everybody got teary-eyed and everything like that. But we should have a bit of caution. Am I glad to be an American? You bet. Am I thankful that God has put me here in this time, in this place? Am I appreciative for the freedoms that I have? Yes. But Christians understand that the United States has 330 million sinners, of whom I am one. And we are not reticent to call out people in our country, including ourselves, to repentance as needed. Now, let's go on with Paul and his teaching to me. Paul says this is what God did. He said, therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, he recognized this was a problem. I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said, my grace is sufficient for you. Three times. I can see that this was not just Paul saying, oh, and by the way, Lord, if I could have this debilitating illness take away, please. I have a feeling the whole church was involved in this. I mean, Paul was prominent. People said, Paul, you would be so much more effective if you could see. We need to pray. We need to get everybody praying. And this was a major thing in the church of God. Wow. Paul, we need you whole. We need you healthy. And they did this not just once, but three times. What is God doing? Why is God not hearing our prayer for our brother Paul? Is this a punishment? But Paul knew the answer. The answer was this. But Jesus said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I'll boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. My grace is sufficient for you. You know, I'm very thankful that God has grace on pastors. I think it was James who said, don't presume to be teachers because teachers will be judged more severely. And there's a dispute whether that means judged by the congregation or judged by God. Might even be both, because we know God's word. And yet, why is it that I have problems with these sins? Why do I have these besetting things that I just have to bring to God weekly, every week, and say, God, why this week was it such a problem for me? God has to say, Tom, my grace is sufficient for you. You see, because my love is undeserved. I don't love you because you are a pastor. I don't love you because you preach four times on a weekend. I don't love you because, you know, you've had a successful ministry, whatever success means. I love you because Jesus died for you. And Paul had to come to that realization himself, even though he preached it fully and completely. And sometimes to know that, for me to understand that, God needs to step away so that I realize I'm not who I think I am. And and what I think I can do is not done just by me alone. Oh, I think I'm in control, but that's just the illusion of the control. I have as much control of my life as the people rearranging the deck chairs as the Titanic's going down. They think they're in control, but really not. My grace is sufficient for you. You might say, I've got great kids, I've made a lot of money, I've served in the military. No, God says, it's all grace. It's all grace. And there are times he'll need to show me this. You know, last time I was with you, I shared with you my story. Certainly had been a successful church planter through two churches and went to California. I figured that was pretty well up to me that I had what it took to start a church in Southern California. But God needed to show me that grace is enough, and that when you are weak, then you are strong. We love to make our kids self-reliant. We love to make sure that they are strong. As a matter of fact, we tell them some things. You probably even said this to your kids. You know, when the going gets tough, the... Okay, yeah, you know that one. Pull yourself up by your... Yeah, there you go. God helps those who... Yeah, you know how many Christians think that's in the Bible? It's not. The little engine that could said, I think I can. Oh, you guys know it all there. We need to caution. While achievement is noble and a work ethic is commanded by God, in our inner spirits, we also need to hold on to brokenness. The psalmist said in Psalm 51, my sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart you will not respond, will not despise. Instead of confidence, God calls on us to have brokenness. Instead of strength, to realize our own weakness. Instead of, I can do it, God has done it for me. Early in 1 Corinthians, Paul had said this. He said, God has made his light shine in our hearts to bring us to the knowledge of God's glory, shining in the face of Christ. Yet we who have this spiritual treasure are like common clay pots. Turn to the person next to you and say, you're a pot. You're a pot. You're a pot. You're a common clay pot. In order to show that the supreme power belongs to God and not to us. How do you make a clay pot? I don't know if you've ever done it, but I've tried it a couple times. I want you to put your hands right where this video is. And if you've ever felt that, it's just a remarkable feeling that as the wheel spins, the clay gradually is molded by your hands. It's a heavy substance, it's a thick substance, but it's pliable. Paul had known that the prophet of Jeremiah had talked about God being the potter, and I am the clay. Mold me and make me your servant today. And as God calls on us to be weak, yes, to be pliable, he will make us up into what he desires, not into what we desire. And he gradually draws us up, and he draws us to himself so that we might be filled with the Spirit. It's a remarkable, remarkable thing, my friends, to recognize that you are weak and have God's Spirit in you. I've had sermons where I thought, well, ushers, let's just give the offering back. This wasn't worth it. And somebody came and said, Pastor Tom, that was remarkable. I guess God spoke. And I've had messages where I thought I was the next Billy Graham, and it just didn't go anywhere. But you know what? God desires to work in us. He wants us to be pliable. He had to do this with Paul very forcefully. And there might be something in your life that God is using to tell you, it's not you, Tom. It's not you, Mary. It's me. Because my grace is sufficient for you. And my power is made perfect When you are weak, you are weak. On Pentecost, we started our service with a response that was actually a song. I don't know how many of you caught that. I was preaching over at Shawnee, and we actually sang that. But it's a wonderful song that has this reflection. It says, Spirit of the living God. And if you know it, you can sing with me. Fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me, melt me, mold me, fill me, use me, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. May that be our prayer this day. Amen? Amen. Dear friends, let's confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. This great God who will build us up as he has broken us down. And because it's good to stand for what you believe in, let's rise as we confess our faith. What do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for a musical meditation.
Blessing of seeing your face in all around me, the light of your glorious grace. Help me to see the needs of your people and be ready to go, Lord, wherever your Spirit leads me. Blessing of walking your way, going wherever you lead me throughout the whole day. Show me the paths that lead where your people need me. Mind your footsteps wherever your Spirit leads me. To my mouth, Lord, the courage to speak of your cross, boldly proclaiming your death was a gain, not a loss, that through your blood, through justice and mercy, may be building your kingdom wherever your Spirit leads me. Give to my heart, Lord, the grace to rejoice in your love, showing forgiveness and mercy and grace from above, that by your word I'll share in the joys you give free. Help me to go, Lord, wherever your Spirit leads me. Jesus, Lord, take me, I offer my whole life to you, and by my service I'll show that I'm faithful and true. Help me to live and praise you, please, Lord, set me free. that you may use me wherever your Spirit needs me.
Friends, let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O Lord, we pray that you would empower us to trust in you at all times and in all things. May we rejoice that your grace is sufficient for us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for those who need your healing power, especially Don Bishop, Pastor Roland Benke, and Pastor Ron Flentgen, Lane Conrad, Carla Doutenhan, Pekka Holmberg, Sandy MacArthur, Ann Ninneman, Ryan Riley, Brenda Trauber, Carolyn Weisheit, Marie McDemmett, Betty Kiker, Elaine Conrad, T.J. Wicknadal, and those we name in our hearts. Grant to each renewed health according to your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, on this 4th of July weekend, we give you thanks and praise for our country and for the freedoms we enjoy. Grant that we remember your generosity and constantly do your will. Bless our land with honest industry, truthful education, and an honorable way of life. Save us from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, from every evil course of action. Make us who came from many nations with many different languages a united people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our leaders. Bless our President Joe, Vice President Kamala, Governors Laura and Mike, Senators, members of Congresses, mayors, judges, and all those in positions of authority. Help them to serve with humility and integrity, and help us to live as responsible citizens of our nation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray for our Growing in God's Great Grace capital campaign, which is currently underway. Continue to bless us as we work on the second half of our goal. We pray that you would give us generous hearts as we share the resources you have entrusted to us to expand your mission and ministry in Western Shawnee. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for your goodness in our lives. We rejoice today with all those who celebrate birthdays, anniversaries, vacations, family times, and other life milestones. We thank you for leading Pastor Luke to accept the call to be our pastor of discipleship. Bless him and his family as they have a time of transition. Help us at all times and in all circumstances to be thankful for all your blessings. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Dear friends, as we prepare to come to the Lord's Supper, we are reminded that Jesus' body and blood are contained, well, are present, really present, in, with, and under this simple bread and wine. And we invite those who recognize that Jesus is truly present here, given for the forgiveness of sins, and who are baptized into Christ and received him as Lord and Savior, to come and join us at this table. And as our time of COVID is ending, do remember that you can come up in family groups as well. We don't need social distancing with those you're not social distant with in your family. It was our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, when the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also, he took the cup after supper. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink you all of it. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We pray together the prayer that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Welcome to the table of the Lord, brothers and sisters. Dear friends, let's rise. Now may this true body and blood strengthen and preserve us in the one true Christian faith to life eternal. May we depart in peace. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you that your strength comes in our weakness, and that in our weakness we have taken this body and blood of Jesus in this mystical way. We pray that you would fill us through this, and that you would cause us to love you more and more and each other more and more. In Jesus' name we pray it. And all God's people said, amen. Let's sing. Dear friends, may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord look upon us with his favor and grant us his peace. Amen. in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And say to that person next to you, you're a clay pot.
Thanks be to God.